And welcome to this event, Listen Up, Understanding Food Justice and Environmental Justice Through Music. If you just tuned in, again, my name is Kristin Reynolds. I'm the chair of the Food Studies program here at the New School, and glad to be co-hosting this with my colleague, Mike Harrington, who is the assistant director of the Tishman Environment and Design Center at the New School. The program is then co-sponsored by our two programs, Food Studies within the Schools of Public Engagement and the Bachelor's program for adults and transfer students, and the university-wide Tishman Environment and Design Center. We want to begin by recognizing that New York City, where the New School is located, is on the unceded territories of the Lenape peoples. And we also recognize that land acknowledgments are both important and can be problematic if they're not accompanied by actions to support Indigenous peoples who are still here. But recognizing people's cultures and the colonial legacy of the land that we are situated on is one part of our program's commitment to action for social and environmental justice through our work, through our educational programs, and our center's focus. So thank you. Also, thanks to those who helped make this event possible tonight. Alexander Scheinert, who was our Associate Director of Communications, Juana Kennedy, our Director of Administration at the Schools of Public Engagement, Claire Stevens, our Student Assistant in the School of Undergraduate Studies, Tia Guerrier, who is here tonight with us, helping us run the webinar, Thomas Aikida, also helping us here at the webinar tonight and from a Research Assistant with the Tishman Center, Anna Yulsman, the Program Director at the Tishman Center, and Tian-Tian He, also a Research Assistant at the Tishman Center. So we had a large group of us working to put this event together. I want to say a few things about the Food Studies program. We're situated, as I mentioned, within the Bachelor's program for adults and transfer students within the Schools of Public Engagement. Students can earn a Bachelor's in Science or a Bachelor's in Arts in Food Studies with concentrations in three areas: culture, media, and communications, food policy and politics, or health and the environment. The program also accepts credits from certain culinary institutions, and we have courses that are open to the public through the university's Open Campus program. So we run a number of events like this one tonight, many of them co-hosted like this one. So just some brief housekeeping. The event is being recorded. We will do the questions and answer after the panel segment, and please use in the webinar the Q&A window for the questions, and then we will get to those at the end. If you're interested in more of our special programs at the New School, you can see events.newschool.edu. And then specific information about food studies is at the email address that you see on the slide, foodstudies@newschool.edu, and about the Tishman Center, tishmancenter.org. So a little bit of brief context for this event. Mike and I were speaking last summer about our common interests in music, and we came up with the idea to organize an event that connected music and our programs at the university's work on food justice and environmental justice. And as we've noted in the event description, which I hope is what attracted, part of what attracted you here today, we know that music can offer references that can speak to diverse communities and open the door for deeper communications about inequity, about justice, and particularly in ways that step away from Eurocentric ways of learning, knowing, and communicating. And so we're really excited to bring together these four leading and inspiring thinkers, activists, and artists on our panel who are doing this work connecting food and environmental justice through music. And so today is the culmination of our food studies program's spring series called Critical Food Studies and Social Justice. And it's also part of the Tishman Center's Earth Week activities. So now I will pass it to Mike to introduce our panelists and give us a little bit more about the Tishman Center.
Thank you, Kristin. Thank you everyone for coming, and thank you to all the panelists. I'm really looking forward to this event and just hearing about what you all have to say. I wanted to share a little bit about the song that you heard at the beginning. So Kristin and I each picked songs to play at the beginning and the end. The song at the beginning was Excess by Rina Sawayama, which is a song about consumption, how that affects us at a global scale. And in her words herself, she said, a part of the song is about the cost of the accelerated pursuit of wealth, The earth is truly taking in as much as it can hold. And even though we have everything we need, we want more at the cost of finite resources and ecological balance. So I thought that fit in pretty well with the theme of what we'll be talking about and Earth Week in general. And we hope the conversation will touch on some of that. So I wanted to let you all know about the Tishman Environmental and Design Center where I work. We're happy to host this along with food studies, and we're going to have a lot more events this month. So if you're really interested in this talk that we're having about music, we're having another event on the 29th of April with the lead Bomba Estéreo, Simeon Mejia, and some other speakers from Colombia talking about the Magdalena River and the culture and music that's coming from that, and also some of the sustainability and environmental relevance that river has to the people of Colombia and to music in general. So hopefully you all can make it to that. And you can go to our website, tishmancenter.org, to see all that. And now I will introduce all of our speakers. Please forgive me if I'm gonna try my best to pronounce everything correctly, but we're very honored to have these four artists, thinkers, and activists joining us today. The first one is Lila June. She is an indigenous musician, scholar, and community organizer of Diné. And Sessa Hestase, did I say it? I know it's really hard to. Sorry, it's.
It's okay.
I'll keep trying. And European lineages. Her dynamic multi-genre presentation style has engaged audiences across the globe towards personal, collective, and ecological healing. She blends studies in human ecology at Stanford, graduate work in indigenous pedagogy, and the traditional worldview she grew up with to inform her music, perspectives, and solutions. She is currently pursuing her doctoral degree, focusing on indigenous food systems revitalization. Our next speaker is Bryant Terry. He is a James Beard and NAACP Image Award-winning chef, educator, and author renowned for his activism to create a healthy, just, and sustainable food system. He is editor-in-chief of Four Color Books, an imprint of Penguin Random House and 10 Speed Press. And he is co-principal and innovation director of ZenMe, a creative studio that he founded. So very, very busy. Since 2015, he's been the chef in residence at the Museum of African Diaspora in San Francisco, where he creates public programming at the intersection of food, farming, health, activism, art, culture, and the African diaspora. His sixth book, a collection of recipes, art, and stories, entitled Black Food, was published by Four Color Books, 10 Speed Press in October 2021. It went on to be the most critically acclaimed American cookbook published that year, landing on lists by the New Yorker, San Francisco Chronicle, Boston Globe, The Washington Post, Time Out, NPR, Los Angeles Times, Food 52, Glamour, Vice, Epicurious, Publishers Weekly, Library Journal, and others. Bryant graduated from the chef's training program at the Natural Gourmet Institute for Health and Culinary Arts in New York City. He is a former PhD student who holds an MA in history with an emphasis on the African diaspora from NYU, where he studied under historian Robin D.G. Kelly. He lives between Oakland and Napa Valley, California, with his wife and his two daughters. Next, we have Dr. Thomas Rashad Easley, who is the child of civil rights activists that protested in the Children's March in 1963 at the height of the civil rights movement and integrated an all-white school in Toledo, Ohio. Dr. Easley was the inaugural assistant dean of community and inclusion at the School of the Environment at Yale University and the inaugural dean of community and inclusion at North Carolina State University. Dr. Easley has attended Alabama A&M University for his bachelor's degree, Iowa State University for his master's degree, and North Carolina State University for his doctorate. Dr. Easley has backgrounds in forestry, genetics, and adult education. He is a certified diversity, equity, and inclusion consultant that works with academic institutions, corporate entities, and other organizations to help them actualize a strong diversity initiative that welcomes everyone and shifts work culture to be equitable. Dr. Easley is also a musical artist, professor, Eagle Scout, and a former campus pastor. He intentionally merges conscious lyrics, ecumenical spirituality, land stewardship, education, diversity, equity, and inclusion principles, and entrepreneurial thinking in his lectures, workshops, and presentations. And last but not least, our colleague at the New School, Dr. Tanya Kalmanovich, is a musician, scholar, and author. So everyone here is a multi-hyphenate, as we can see. Kal Malevich's Tar Sands Stone Songbook, an autobiographical solo show, uses storytelling, personal history, and live music to illuminate the profound environmental and human impacts of extractivism in her birthplace of Fort McMurray, Alberta, Canada. With the support of the MAP Fund and the Canada Council for the Arts, Dr. Kal Malevich is launching a multi-year performance tour along the pipeline, rail, and truck routes that connect Alberta oil to global markets to accelerate community conversations about just transition. Dr. Kal Malevich has been named to the GRIS 50 Fixers, Artists in Residence with the Climate Action Network Canada, RASU Action Climate Canada, and a member of the Mission Circle of Scale Les Sautes, a network mobilizing the Canadian arts and culture sector in the climate emergency. She is co-principal investigator of the National Endowment of the Arts Research Lab and the Sustainable Entrepreneurship and the Performing Arts at New York University, and an associate professor of music entrepreneurship at the New School in New York City. So without further ado, I'll pass it back to Kristin to get us started with the discussion.
Thank you, Mike. And again, welcome to all of our amazing panelists and artists. What I failed to say at the very beginning was the structure of our event. So from this point forward, we will have a panel discussion where we will also be playing videos and music from each of the panelists, and then we'll get to the Q&A. So I have a first question that I'm going to ask each person to respond to. So as you know, this event centers the idea that music can open the door for deeper understandings of inequity and justice, as I mentioned, that step away from Eurocentric insistence on linear and written communication to teach, exchange knowledge, or debate. So with that said, to get started, we wondered if you would each tell us a little bit about your work and art, and perhaps if there are ways that you see your work contributing to broader recognition of diverse knowledges and communications. And I'll just leave it to you to decide who wants to jump in first.
Oh, don't do that to us.
You started.
Just kidding. So nice to be here. Ya'at'e, shik'e, aro shididne'e. Greetings, my kin and my people. She'e nanisht ejitachitni nishlo. I am from the nanisht ejitachitni clan of the Diné Nation, which I got from my mother line. And we're also incorrectly known as Navajo, which is not actually our name. My father's clan is the Tsetsessis Washishchi, which is the Cheyenne word for Cheyenne. And so happy to be here. Taos New Mexico, Dayna Shangwit Ego Dene Asanishla. So I'm originally from Taos, New Mexico, and in that manner I present myself as a Dene woman. So honored to be here and excited to be with all you wonderful people. I got to Google all my fellow panelists just now and learn about their work. So it's really amazing what you're all doing. I really love this question of broadening knowledges, broadening communication styles. I went to Stanford for my undergrad and, you know, got my master's, doing my PhD. So I know that world of like APA, you know, style research papers and making sure that you cross all your T's and dot all your I's. And that definitely is a highly colonial form of communication. And every time we participate in it, we kind of accidentally reinforce this mythology that it is the source of knowledge. And I am all about dismantling that, even though I am, you know, in these programs. I will say though that for my master's and for my PhD, I went specifically to schools, University of New Mexico and University of Alaska Fairbanks, that are very actively critiquing these institutions of knowledge and actively dismantling them. So I couldn't probably stomach anything like Stanford ever again. It's like I've been there, done that, never gonna do it again. I love places that are actively critiquing how we construct knowledge, what counts as knowledge, who gets to share knowledge and who doesn't, because they have these random degrees that are very Eurocentric in nature. So I'm all about it. And for my master's degree, I actually, it was in education, and the whole thing, I got to build a summer school with my people. And my my master's chair of my committee, he said, build the hogan, which is our traditional ceremonial structure. He said, build your hogan with your people and your hogan will be your thesis. And I loved that because he's right. The hogan has so much knowledge encoded in it, so much symbology, takes so much work to build. You create relationships with people as you build it. And in the indigenous, you know, educational model, everything is relationships. If you don't have good relationships with your people, nothing you write matters. So it's all about relationship building and kinship. In fact, there's a really big book in our sort of world called Research is Ceremony, written by Sean Wilson. That's kind of been our Bible in the native academic world for a few years now, of just like, how do we reapproach research so that it is accountable not to Eurocentric stuff, but accountable to our elders, accountable to our songs, accountable to our languages, our medicine bundles, et cetera. And to be accountable to that requires relationships. So that was really fun to do my master's thesis. I did end up writing an actual written thesis as well to accompany the hogan, but it was secondary. And then, you know, for music, of course, this is, you know, I forget what, I read this quote years ago that said, Justin Bieber has a greater social media influence than the Pope and the Dalai Lama combined, or something like that. And I think maybe the point of that is that music can be such a very active, profound vehicle of communication that lives outside of these academic bubbles. Whereas much of our research, hopefully not, but oftentimes, too often, it sits on a shelf and no one reads it, you know, or it's only read by a specific slice of the world, because it, only that slice has access to it, right? So, but music is this very inviting medium through which we can educate. And also, you know, it doesn't educate just the mind, it educates the soul and the heart. And I think that's one of its strengths, is that when I sometimes do presentations at schools or something, and I will, you know, talk to their brain, you know, give them PowerPoint. And then after it's all done with, I will actually sing a song. And usually that's the thing they remember way more than the PowerPoint, because it was speaking to their whole body. It was speaking to their whole heart. And so I think that we often, you know, don't do justice to music as a vehicle for education, or put it on a high of a pedestal as we would like a dissertation or something like that. But it actually has a lot of strengths. I won't say it's, I think they all have strengths. All different media have strengths to communicate certain things, but music clearly is built to speak to our bodies, speak to their heartbeats, speak to our bones, and get us up and dancing and embodying some of these ideas. So that's just my little two cents on that. And I think overall, I like that you all are framing music education or music communication as a decolonizing act. I like that, because so much of what we spin our wheels doing is to placate the colony, to placate this this hegemony, this assumed entitlement to what is true, what is truth, what is worth doing. And I think by really questioning that and positioning music as a legitimate place, source of information, we're further breaking down these walls that close us in, these colonial walls that aren't even real walls, they're just imaginary, yet we live by them every day. And one of the last things I'll say is that as Indigenous people, our culture is very disposable in our own homeland. You can live and die in this country, know nothing about Native people, and do just fine. It's not essential knowledge, either pragmatically or even ethically, within our country. however, you couldn't last one day without knowing English. You know, you couldn't last one day without knowing the ritual of a credit score. You wouldn't last one day if you wouldn't know the ritual of a mortgage, or, you know, all of these strange cultural artifacts that are, that make up this neo-colonial society. But as Native people, we're trying to make our knowledge more essential and say, hey, actually, you're on our land. And you're actually guests on our land, and you always have been. And it would be nice if you took some time to learn our way, you know, to learn whose land you're on. When in Rome, you know, you do as the Romans do, you know, to be respectful and to honor, although I don't really like Rome, but, you know, you take the time to honor whose homeland you're on. So I think that would be good for us to do in general, as we think about not just changing how we exchange knowledge, but changing the language through which we speak, learning the indigenous languages, learning the ceremonies, learning the symbols, learning the devices, architecture, et cetera, so that we can be respectful guests in another's home.
I could jump in. First want to call in my blood ancestors on whose shoulders I stand: Rosalie Terry, Andrew Johnson Terry, Margie Bryant, and Edward Bryant. Beef, what a relief. When will this poisonous product cease? This is another public service announcement. You can believe it or you can doubt it. Let us begin now with the cow, the way that it gets to your plate and how. The cow doesn't grow fast enough for man, so through his greed, he creates a faster plan. He has drugs to make the cow grow quicker. Through the stress, the cow gets sicker. 21 different drugs are pumped into the cow in one big lump. And just before it dies, it cries in a slaughterhouse full of germs and flies. I'll stop there because it does get much more graphic. But I shared the lyrics to the song Beef by the seminal hip hop group Boogie Down Productions with their lead MC KRS-One, which is an acronym, Knowledge Reigns Supreme Over Nearly Everyone. So you can imagine that every song he does is pretty much a dissertation. I share that song because that song Beef was a major catalyst for me as a high school student for transforming my habits and attitudes and politics regarding food. And I remember the day so clearly that I heard that song and I was just blown away. And I went to my dad and I asked him to get me the tape, Edutainment, on which that song was a part of that album. And he said he'd get it for me if I first would go to the library and check out this book called The Jungle by Upton Sinclair. It was written in 1906 and it was about the kind of ills of the meatpacking industry in the Midwest in the early 20th century. And so in terms of my, and I really traced that period back to, I would argue that was the kind of moment that I became a food justice activist. And I think it's important to note that song and this novel were the primary text that, you know, just changed everything for me. It wasn't a heady intellectual lecture or some scholarly monograph. And, you know, after that, I, you know, fast forward to 1998, I was a graduate student at NYU, and research that I was doing on the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense, specifically the work that they were doing at the intersection of poverty, malnutrition, and institutional racism, their grocery giveaways, their free breakfast for children program. It really moved me to enter this field as an adult. And that was the moment that I decided I wanted to commit my life to working on food justice issues. And so I would go to these national gatherings geared towards fixing our food system. And I was bothered by the way in which most of these spaces were predominantly white. They often had, you know, these very clear educational and class biases that permeated these spaces. And the people who are most impacted by our broken food system, the people living on the margins, whether it's, you know, small to mid-sized farmers who are hanging on by a string, or people living in urban centers often described as food deserts. A lot of food justice activists have largely rejected that term, and we talk about food apartheid. I was clear that I wanted to have an approach that brought more people to the table, widened the table, and allowed more people to feel welcome. And I knew that the use of art and culture and music could be a powerful way to do that. And I also saw that including these things in my work would help reintegrate what I see our industrialized food system really stripping away, where we've created food as a commodity on one side, and all the things that have been so integral to the way that we grow food and cook it and eat it traditionally, music and art and culture and community, they're all the way over here. So I really see my work kind of bridging that chasm. And when my co-author from my first book, Anna LaPay, and I were writing the book, we came up with this concept of grub parties, where we would invite people to our apartments in Brooklyn, and we would get food from local sources, the farmer's market, and we would make it communally, and we would connect around the table. And we really saw that as a powerful way for starting these conversations around food politics. And that's when I developed this kind of philosophy of starting with the visceral to ignite the cerebral and ending at the political, being very clear that, you know, if we, in order for us to fix our broken system, we need to look at these structural inequalities. We need to look at the, you know, thinking about the communities that I've been most focused on, people living in cities on the margins. We need to think about the physical, the economic, the geographic barriers that prevent people from accessing healthy, fresh, affordable, and culturally appropriate food. And I started this organization called Be Healthy that worked with young people, you know, really recognizing that some of our most powerful social movements, just in the 20th century, thinking about like the civil rights movement in the American South, the anti-apartheid movement in South Africa, and how young people, their brilliance, their bravery, their, you know, just ability to put it all on the line, really push these movements forwards. And I argued that if we want to have a successful food justice movement, we need to be training vanguard of young people to be the ones who are leading this movement. And I, you know, we talk about food justice, I think it's important to recognize that food justice moves beyond advocacy and direct service and calls for organized responses that are owned and driven by the people who are impacted by food apartheid. You know, it shouldn't be driven by philanthropic organizations. It shouldn't be driven by these snow-capped NGOs, but it should be driven by people in communities on the ground doing the work. And so when I moved into cookbook writing, understanding the power that that could have to further base build and, you know, get people excited about food justice, and also to, you know, help people engage in cooking practices. I was very clear that our industrialized food system has divorced so many of us from just the regular practice of growing food and cooking it. And people, you know, need to have those skills because a lot of people aren't doing it. And I really saw cookbooks as a tool for empowering people to develop a regular cooking practice. And so with my cookbooks, I'd say my first book, Grub, we really laid the blueprint or the kind of like infrastructure for all my subsequent books, which was combining heady intellect, you know, essays that talked about the problems of our broken food system, and really giving people a deeper understanding of it. And then, you know, having action steps so that people don't feel hopeless, but giving them some, you know, real tools for addressing this, both, you know, kind of individually as consumers and eaters, but also thinking about community-wide change, and then thinking about, you know, how we can shift public policies to ensure that, you know, the decisions are made in the best interest of eaters and not just, you know, the handful of multinational corporations that largely control our food system. And so with the, and then that first book, we ended it with menus. So recipes that were structured as menus, really aimed at getting people to eat more local, seasonal, sustainable food. And then with every recipe, I commissioned a lino cut artist, is New York based Afro-Puerto Rican artist Tenjin Akita, to do 4 lino cuts, which represented each season. And each menu came with a suggested soundtrack of music that was thematically connected, or, you know, I might've just been listening to an album a million times when I was testing the recipes. And so I'll end by saying that, you know, for me, ultimately, all the work that I do, I'm so glad that my work around these issues started as a grassroots activist when I founded this organization, Be Healthy, in New York, because it's really the lens through which I see all the work that I do, inspired by the Black Panthers and other revolutionary groups. But just understanding that And I'll quickly say this, you know, when I was very clear. So my advisor in graduate school, Robin D.G. Kelly, his second scholarly monograph, Race Rebels, kind of looks at labor movement through a different lens. And he looked at some of the everyday practices of, you know, Black folks dealing with capitalism and white supremacy and, you know, just these everyday acts of resistance, like breaking tools and, you know, quitting on the spot or sabotage, and how those were ways that people organized and built this base outside of organized labor movements. And it really helped me understand things that I think often people see as apolitical and the political nature of them, whether we're talking about growing food or getting food from local sources, certainly growing food in home gardens or community gardens, eating, you know, local seasonal sustainable meals, building community around the table. Food system that's largely controlled by five multinational food corporations, I would say these are highly political, dare I say, radical acts of resistance. You know, these corporations, they want us buying the food from their crappy, overpriced corporate stores. They want us eating our meal over the sink or in the car as we're going from one low-wage job to another. And, you know, so I think that I had to learn to value those things, these everyday acts of resistance, as much as like the kind of like long-term base building and even thinking about making interventions in public policy. So, and not that, yeah, we could talk about my changing thoughts on that, but I think the most important thing that I've been seeing over the past 2 years is people really understanding that, you know, especially with the inept response by our government to this public health crisis and the kind of further widening of the wealth gap and the concentration of wealth in the hands of the elites, that, you know, we need to be thinking about creating systems outside of capitalism that are going to care for and sustain our people. And I'm just constantly thinking about ways to continue to help us all think about how we can be active in creating that world.
Yes, thank you. Thomas, would you like to speak next?
Sure. Here's my minority report about what's going on with the poor. No clean water, got liquor stores. No banks, got housing, can't afford. Got drugs, got guns, got more. Dope boys, no books, gym floors. Dead pool, can't swim, lead in my pores. Contaminated, mentally challenged, I'm sore. Getting scholarships while my body earns scores. I want to use my mind then to explore. But crooked, scared cops stand at my door. Said I resemble this dude that shot for. But I don't own a gun, but I am at war. Still praying about who came after the 44th. President evidence there won't be no more. Black folk for a while, not expecting support. So that was a 16 from actually not even my song, it's another person's song, so I didn't send it to you. But it's called All Eyes on We. It's one of the artists that's on my label, the Easley Branch. But that 16, I also would, as we say in hip hop, I would spit that when I would be out recruiting and talking about natural resources and talking about forestry. So I'm also a forester. That's the other thing that's that, you know, just to let everyone know. And recognizing that I'm part of an industry that also stole some, if not a lot, of its technology from indigenous peoples. So, you know, I would wrap that to recruit students. They come to the institution I was working in, then I would be teaching this class that was, I'll be honest, it was targeting students of color. So I would have indigenous students in my class, African American students, Latinx students. And then slowly over time, a couple of white students slid in and a couple of Asian students slid in. And it was like, that was the one class where the students could let their hair down. They could be themselves. Like, you can come in, you can be yourself. And we would look at every discipline that they were studying and we would analyze why they didn't see their culture reflected in that discipline. I said, it's a reason why you don't see it. And it's not because we don't exist. And then I would use that class we would strengthen these students. We would get ready for the ignorant things people would say. I was like, we're gonna talk about why affirmative action shouldn't exist. And we're gonna talk about what a real bootstrap is. And whose people actually had a bootstrap and who's actually had affirmative action. And everyone in this room seems to have actual bootstraps. And so we would talk about that, talk about our history. And so then when they would leave my class, and students would come in all the time at first and be like, man, why am I in this class? And then later on in the year, student would come and be like, Doc, you believe somebody said that I'm only here because of affirmative action? I was like, and what did you say back to them? And see, my students, they wouldn't complain about what people said. They would nip it right there as soon as it was done. Because I told them, if I'm not here, you have to do this on your own. You have to do this because these systems that we're in, we didn't create them, but I believe that we can dismantle them. And so I would use hip hop. And what would end up happening, fortunately for me, I'm wearing a t-shirt of one of my artists right now. I'm gonna go ahead and pull it down so you can see it. It's B, the name of the album is 2020 BC, meaning before COVID. And he's just brilliant. He's like my favorite artist in the world, besides the Blastmaster KRS-One and Ice Cube of all time. But anyway, and he was one of my, he don't mind me telling me, he was one of my students who ended up incarcerated, wrongly incarcerated, who ended up coming and living with me when he got out and started the label together, Easily Branch. And everybody that's on the branch is family, and they were my former students. And now they're making money, making the music, but the music is called Save Your Life Music. And so in order to get on the label, you would have to pass my class. It wasn't an easy class. And then if you pass the class, that's when we would talk about music. And you can make technically whatever music you want, as long as it's not denigrating people and it's elevating people and making space, you know, for others. So we infuse diversity, equity, and inclusion work, as I do with people, I would put it in the music. And so we intentionally make our music so that we can connect with people and open it so that they can connect with us. We also use our music to be unapologetic about who we are. And we use our music to claim back our power and to tell our own story and to tell our narrative. And so for one educator to the rest of the educators, that's how we use our music. And I'm learning from everybody here right now. So I think that's about it. Thanks.
I just have to pick up on what you just said, Thomas, is that I'm learning so much from listening to all of you. Thank you for your testimony. Thank you for sharing, all of you, who you are, where you come from, who your ancestors are. I'll tell you a little about myself. The question was about our artistic practice and our work. So I didn't know this about myself, but I was born in Fort McMurray, Alberta, in the north of Alberta. It's the source of the, up until recently, one quarter of the United States oil supply. And I am a child of oil country. I did not know that about myself. It was the ordinary feature of my life. It was also the place where my mother and father went seeking some kind of a, what was imagined to be a 20th century better future. My mother grew up on a subsistence farm in central Manitoba. She grew up, as she told me, learning to honor the land because it was the difference between starving and staying alive. And I grew up with a mingled sense of messages. And on one hand said, erase your Ukrainian identity, erase your ethnicity, assimilate, and move into progress. So when my mother moved to Fort McMurray, it was a space a little bit like a war zone that convenes people from such different backgrounds in different places. This massive infrastructure of extraction industry. This is where my mother heard a symphony orchestra for the first time. It's later on when she went to Edmonton that she took her first ride on an escalator or an elevator. And she put me in violin lessons as soon as she could, because not because she wanted me to be a musician, but because she wanted me to be educated. She wanted me to be a familiar of beauty. She wanted me to be a familiar of greater opportunities than she had available to her. And it took me a long time to unlearn the structures of Eurocentric colonial music education, to learn that my violin was also a fiddle, to learn, and this has been a lifelong process for me. So a lot of my work in the last few years has been organized around a kind of a conscious reconciliation and reckoning with the circumstances of my birth. And the fact that it was oil money and the employment in the oil industry that drove the economy of the place where I was from, that was the conditions of my birth, and that required in me kind of a relearning, a renegotiating of the basic circumstances of my life, that I needed no reason to exist or to make music or to make a sound other than the fact of my birth. But I did a thing that was a little bit unusual for a child of my class and place and time, which was that I seized upon the violin as a kind of a technology. There was an infrastructure in place thanks to imperialism. There was an infrastructure in place that if you learned how to take the teachings and learnings and do what your teachers told you to do, you could get better and better, and you could audition and you could get out. And I went from being a first generation college goer to going into Juilliard in New York City, which was a massive culture shock for me. And I think it took about another 30 years after that to understand that the thing that defines me the most, what gives me my strength and what gives me my voice, is my grandmother's hands. And it was her teaching me how to live in relationship to the land. It was her living the lessons to me of a life before oil. And so I remember her right now in particular when I make cabbage rolls, kalabchi, when I make vareniki or pierogies, when I make pickles, which I have a hard time reconciling the fact I live in Brooklyn. I mean, in 2008, I went to a pop-up market in Dumbo where a guy was selling pickles for $14 a jar. And I had like this drop down moment, like pickles. I mean, pickles, this is just what we did. And so I realized that I have a kind of a strength, which is that I do know how it is to live in two worlds at once. And I know how to play the fiddle and the violin. I know what it is to live in New York City. And I know what it is to live in a life before oil. And those are the values that I'm trying to live out. And then I'm trying to teach to the students that I work with, and the things that I'm trying to unlearn, and the Eurocentric colonial bits, and the power that I'm trying to come into a continually closer relationship with, and to grow and to share with others.
Thank you so much. As I was telling Tanya before the event, I was wanting to try things as I was reading her comments. And now I feel more hungry, also ready to make some food out of Bryant's book after this event. So talk about that later. So now we're going to move into the second question with our musical samples. And we are going to start with Lila. And I'm just gonna delve right into it. Actually, no, I'm sorry. I have to look at my questions here. So this is the question we've asked everybody to think about with respect to their music or their video that they've sent us. And it is this: each of you integrate thinking and action about food justice or food sovereignty or environmental justice into your work or artistry. And so we'd like to play a sample from each of your works and then ask you if you could speak a bit about how you connect music, food, environment, and justice. So here we go.
Indigenous people, shine your light, we are equal. I remember the days when our prayers were illegal. I remember the days when being Indian was lethal. Yeah, we had a rough past, but get ready for the sequel. Get ready for the glorious comeback of our people, oh yeah. Rise up, all you warriors of love, all you answers to the prayers of our ancestors from above. I can feel it in my heart, can you feel it in your blood? I can hear the seventh fire calling us to wake up. All nations rise up, 'cause now's your time. We don't have to hide anymore, 'cause now's the time. All nations rise up, 'cause now's your time. We don't have to hide anymore, 'cause now's the time. With forgiveness as my bow and my prayers as my arrows, pull them back and let go. I watch them fly like sparrows, have hope. Yeah, have hope. With compassion as my shield and faith down to my marrow, I will walk the pollen path even when it gets narrow. Yeah, yeah, I resurrect. Yes, you can bet.
that we seen the single mama raising children on the res. We seen domestic violence tear apart what we have left. We seen the alcohol take it all and leave us dead. We seen the children take their lives when they can't take the dread anymore.
It's a war.
Can't take the dread anymore.
It's a war.
No, we can't take the dread anymore.
It's a war.
No, we can't take the dread anymore.
It's a war.
Yeah. It's a war, but we've seen it all before. And now we know we can change it, cause that's why we were born. We know we are the ones that we have been waiting for. We are the ones Grandma has been praying for.
So rise up, all you warriors of love. All you answers to the prayers of our ancestors from above. I can feel it in my heart. Can you feel it in your blood?
I can hear the seventh fire calling us to wake up.
Wake up.
Levántense, es nuestro tiempo.
No tienes que esconderte más.
Ahora es nuestro tiempo.
Mujer indígena, tú eres tan sagrada. Traigas medicina de tu suelo todavía.
A pesar del abuso de tu cuerpo y tu tierra,
respetamos tus ancestros y la suya cultura.
Hombre indígena, tú eres honorable y yo veo la fuerza que todavía sobrevive.
A pesar del abuso de tu raza venerable,
yo respeto tus ritos, tus danzas, tus padres.
Somos guerreros del amor y guerreros de la paz. Sí,
no vamos a escondernos más.
Somos guerreros del amor y guerreros de la paz. Sí,
no vamos a escondernos más.
They say that history is written by the victors, but how can there be a victor when the war isn't over? The battle has only just begun, and Creator is sending his very best warriors. And this time, it isn't Indians versus cowboys. No, this time, it is all the beautiful races of humanity together on the same side, and we are fighting to replace our fear with love. And this time, bullets, arrows, and cannonballs won't save us. The only weapons that are useful in this battle are the weapons of truth, faith, and compassion.
Amateur mistake. Amazing. Thank you so much. We want to make sure that we get through all the music and all the comments, so I'm going to ask each person to talk for like a couple of minutes about that question and how it represents your work, and I'll stop talking now to give you the floor, Lila.
Yes, no problem. I know we're panels always take longer than we think. I guess I'll just quickly say that, you know, this idea that we don't have to hide anymore as Indigenous peoples and all peoples really, and honoring all of our Indigenous roots, wherever we're from, wherever our ancestors are from, that we can like honor that, bring that out. So as it relates to the food work I do, it's really about excavating the history that's been hidden about this continent. A lot of people frame Native people as primitive, as savage, as these very sparsely populated nomads running around trying to find food, eating hand to mouth. And my dissertation's a lot about like, no, we extensively managed this whole continent. We created beautiful Edens and we designed Edens all throughout this continent very intentionally. And a lot of these landscapes were actually anthropogenic in nature. They were man-made and so, or woman-made or people-made. And so, really dispelling this myth of the primitive Indian, really dispelling this myth that this was all wild nature when the Europeans landed, and really reminding people that they're standing on relics, you know, relics of food systems that you can see sometimes little vestiges of these still today. And a lot of these food systems have been crippled, you know, the chestnuts, the oyster fisheries, the clam gardens, the corn, beans, and squash fields placed at the small bottom of small watersheds, All the grasslands that were maintained by routine indigenous fire burning every fall to keep the grasslands healthy, on and on and on, all of these things that we would do to take care of the land and ensure a predictable food source, that needs to be remembered, that needs to be honored. And what's beautiful about knowing about that it happened is that we know we could do it again. So that's, it's exciting. So that's how it connects to my food work, just bringing all this stuff out from hiding and saying, no, this happened, you know, this history can't be hidden any longer.
Wow, thank you so much. I'm reading the chat too. Now we're going to move to a song by Thomas. Oh, I'm sorry, hang on a second. Yeah, that's right. Sorry, getting messed up. Mike's queuing it up.
Oh, sorry, just pulling it up.
We can all reflect on that music. And actually, this is good because I was actually planning to say something else, which is, as I mentioned at the beginning of the event, we invite you to put your devices down and really focus on the music. You can close your eyes and listen to it. We're going to have a slide and audio as soon as we get it up. Mike, we could pass to the next person and then, and I can do that. Should I do that? You got it. Okay.
Gray miles fly high, never landing. Southern black jets building country mansions. Plant seeds, growing trees, let us breathe. Gray miles fly high, never landing. Southern black jets building country mansions. Plant seeds, growing trees, let us breathe. Ooh,
Alabama's finest. I'm the planet's greatest. I own that I'm country. Repeat it, overstated. Alabama's finest. I'm the planet's greatest. I own that I'm country. Read, and I made it. Special educated, obese and overweighted. Lyrically can't be baited. My clique is separated from y'all that be playing. Got thoughts, never say it. Not trying to steal your thunder. No, I don't okay it. Silence communication. Already lost my patience. No more time for waiting. Fragile peeps are aggravating. And now we activating. Let our soul glow, cause we making food for the soul. Taste the white nationalist. They hate it. If I succeed, was not made for me. No debating that I'm better, clever. Literally, I'm the treasure. You can't take it. They kill us cause they can't be us. Why you faking? Hey, changes can't fix it if you don't face it.
Gray miles fly high, never landing. Southern black jets building country mansions. Plant seeds, growing trees, let us breathe. Gray miles fly high, never landing. Southern black jets building country.
Never overrated, Afro Carolina. Aren't you glad you waited? Carolina's finest, never overrated, Afro Carolina. Aren't you glad you waited? Red clay rambling, sand hills jamming, magnolia in my hair, pine tree climbing. This is the part where we get a fresh start. This is the part where we speak from the heart. Still rising up, never coming down. Can't you hear the ocean? Can't you hear the sound? Still rising up, never coming down. Can't you hear the ocean? Can't you hear that sound? Ancestral voices, angelic voices, freedom voices, revolution. Ancestral voices, angelic voices, freedom voices, revolution.
Gray miles fly high, never landing. Southern black jets building country mansions. Plant seeds, growing trees, let us breathe. Country mansions. Gray miles fly high, never landing. Southern black jets building country mansions. Plant seeds, growing trees, let us breathe. Water when the roots break ground.
country mansions, ooh, gray miles fly high, never landing. Let us pray.
Appreciate it. You know, it's different when you listen to it, and you haven't listened to it in a while. But anyway, you know, so that's my crew. That's the Great Minds Alliance, you know, there that you were just hearing. So that's why it's saying great highs, great minds fly high, never land in Southern Black gents, but in country mansions. And, you know, I mean, I think the song kind of spoke, you know, for itself, you know, how we, you know, we're claiming, you know, loving Afro-Carolina, you know, loving where we're from, me claiming being from Alabama, and, you know, and owning being country. But there were other pieces in there towards the end, you know, and I was like, they kill us because they can't be us. You know, parts when I was, you know, saying, you can't, hey, genius, you can't fix it if you won't face it. You know what I'm saying? If I succeed, I'm better clever. White nationalists, they hate it. You know, so, you know, I don't mind calling out my enemies, but at the same time, I don't mind calling in people at the same time, because depending on what side of the spectrum you're on, they could actually potentially be allies. So in that song, we're really trying to, you know, really just say that we can do it together, and that, you know, not trying to steal the thunder from my guy Sitch, but the hook and everything he's saying, I wrote that. And so I remember we were trying to figure out how to sing and say, love is when roots, you know, break the ground. And he was just like, what does this mean, Doc? And then I started talking about the trees and the plants again. I'm like, listen, you know, you have to understand that if we're separated from that, from the ground, which a lot of our people are, we're separated from each other. And so I was like, my grandfather taught me that the tree is my relative. So I was like, that's what that means. Sing it like that. And that's what the song is, you know. So Country Mansions is something that's in as, you know, as Lila said, is in the heart, is in the head, and it's in the body. And then it ends up being in the spirit and everything that we do. So that's it. And if I didn't answer the question, listen to the song again. All right.
You answered the question. Thank you so much. Just loving this whole panel and session. And I need to stop talking. Our next video is a video from Bryant.
Whenever I bite into black eyed peas, I feel like I'm embraced by my community, whether I'm far from home or in my own backyard. I'm Brian Terry, a Bay Area-based author, editor-in-chief of the Four Color Books imprint, and resident chef at the Museum of the African Diaspora. Black eyed peas are a powerful symbol of the cultural ties that bind together the African diaspora. My spirit travels straight to Bahia, Brazil when I eat acarajé, deep-fried black-eyed pea fritters served by street vendors dressed in all white. Through these dishes and others, history finds me. For African Americans, black-eyed peas are a symbol of good luck and fortune, and eating them on New Year's Day is a sacred tradition. Black-eyed peas, which symbolize pennies, are often slow-simmered in a big pot, or they show up in dishes like Hoppin' John, along with a skillet of cornbread, which symbolizes gold, and a pot of dark leafy greens, which symbolize dollars. One of my favorite dishes to share with friends is barbecue black-eyed peas. The beans slow cook in a pot with aromatics and fresh herbs, while onions, garlic, and bell peppers, and more, come together into a rich, tangy, smoky homemade barbecue sauce. When that sauce hits those beans, the fragrance is otherworldly, and I know my ancestors are dining with me.
So real quick, I, especially since Black Food came out in the fall, I would even say before it came out, when Korsha Wilson wrote this profile for me on the New York Times, I knew the book's publication would take my career to the next level, but it really, that Times piece just catapulted me in the stratosphere in a way that I just didn't expect to happen so quickly. And so I get approached to do brand partnerships probably weekly, and I'm very selective. I rarely do them, but I actually started this creative agency, Zenme, which is a mashup of my daughter's names, Fumilayo and Zinzile. And if I choose to do a brand partnership, I need to have completely creative control. I would say almost complete, because these folks always have notes, but I want to have like the team. I want to build the team out. We have a team, a stable of photographers, videographers, musicians. And so Stella approached me about doing this partnership for Black History Month. And I asked them for what I wanted, and I got everything and was able to pull this brilliant team together. So that commercial, that was like from the ground up, we conceived of that. I conceived of this whole idea. And I just want to say that, you know, one of the part and parcel of this larger project of my work is really helping all of us have a more complicated understanding of what Black food is. I think oftentimes when people hear Black food, they think about, you know, soul food, and really they're just thinking like, well, that's what Black people eat. And it's a very reductive way that it's often thought about, the kind of antebellum survival foods, which is often, you know, kind of vilified as slave food, but that's a very simplistic way of thinking about the way that enslaved Africans or free Blacks during that period would grow, cook, and eat food. Or people reduce it to the kind of big flavored meats and overcooked vegetables and desserts that you find at soul food restaurants. But it leaves out this whole, it's just a range of just like simple foods that Black folks in the rural South and other parts have just cooked, just simple, you know, staples, black-eyed peas, sugar snap peas, pole beans, sweet potatoes, and all the things that my family would grow, cook, and eat. And so with that piece, my creative director and I conceived of the theme, really helping us, you know, think about the diaspora and black-eyed peas as a symbol for the way in which, you know, ingredients and people traveled from Western Central Africa throughout the globe, and how that kind of connects all of the different Black folks throughout the diaspora. I wrote it. I hired one of my favorite videographers, Kamisi Norwood, to shoot it. My friend Martine Pirina, who's a founding member of the group Antibalas, which is an Afrobeat band. He did the music. And so, I mean, at the end of the day, it's a beer commercial, but I really felt like it would be a powerful way to just talk about what I like to kind of tongue in cheek describe as Black superfoods. And I know that's like a marketing term that, you know, corporations use to like sell whatever the latest trend is, you know, the food of the Andes, quinoa or acai from Brazil. But because Black food is vilified so often, and because, you know, Black folks have been dealing with this exponential rise in diet-related illnesses over the past, you know, several decades, I always say that one of the paths to our liberation, and an important path, is consuming our cultural foods. What are the foods that our ancestors ate? How did they sustain them and help them thrive? And we need to be eating them. We needn't look any further than our own traditional staples and ingredients and flavor profiles in order to help us to thrive. So yeah, that's it.
Awesome. I was so hungry every time I watched that movie or that video and want a beer. So last but not least, we have a video from Tanya.
My name is Tanya Kalmanovich, and I'm working on a new project, a documentary play with music called The Tar Sands Songbook. For most of my life, if someone asked me where I was from, I didn't have an easy answer. Fort McMurray wasn't on the map. But a few years ago, something changed. Projects like the Keystone XL pipeline became front page news, and suddenly, I didn't have to explain where I was from. I could just say oil sands, and not only did people know where it was, they had opinions about it. It's like this guy I met who said he'd gone to Fort McMurray because he wanted to see ground zero for climate change. Ground zero. This is where I was born. It's where my dad's ESSO station was. It's where my mother heard a symphony orchestra for the first time. My father moved us there to work for the Great Canadian Oil Sands. My stepfather was an engineer for Suncor. Oil convened the people and forces that shaped my life. 50 years ago, they opened the world's first oil mine near Fort McMurray. A trailblazing industrial experiment turned Canada into a world energy leader. But it's also transformed the land and its people irreparably. I became a musician because it had nothing to do with oil. It's taken me until now to see that the things I had imagined to be separate, music and oil, past and progress, art and business, remote northern towns and the capitals of the world are in fact closely intertwined. Oil, like music, is an elixir of possibility. As a child, music seduced me with beauty, promise, and dreams. Oil, as it turns out, is not so different. There are many things we can't change, but one thing we can change is the story we tell about ourselves. So last year, I went back to Fort McMurray for the first time since I was a child, and further north to Fort Chipewyan, a small community downstream from the mining operations. I interviewed engineers, indigenous activists, heavy equipment operators, elders, scientists, and members of my own family. Their stories and mine are the heart of the Tar Sands Songbook. It's a documentary play with music about how we remember our life before oil and how we imagine our life after oil. We might spend a minute or two on a news article or a few seconds on a soundbite. But in a theater, audiences gather to wrestle collectively with complex issues, and they're doing it together in real time. For this piece, I've written songs with sparrows, propane cannons, and pipelines.
I hear, like, rubble.
Sounds like Mordor.
And I've also been searching for other notes. Not just notes of fear, but the notes of joy and resilience. These are the songs of the Tar Sands Songbook. We've turned a corner in our conversation about climate change. But after the oil sands pass the event horizon, their legacy will be felt for generations to come. This project offers an opening. Knowing about oil and the urgency of climate change is different from entering into these issues imaginatively. I'm hoping to offer people a way to explore their relationships to energy, the choices they make, and the possibilities for the future.
Oh, I have such complicated reactions watching that. That is also a commercial. And it's a commercial that I produced myself. I wrote it, I shot it, except for the aerial footage, which was gifted to me by Greenpeace. I did this not as a videographer, not as a filmmaker, not as a playwright, but as a fiddle player. And it is very much a testament of me circa 2017, trying to figure out how to start to break a silence that permeates everything about oil in the place where I'm born. It is the kind of thing where, the best equivalent I have for, like, my, you know, sort of white and white adjacent friends in the United States, it was like after November 2016, when people went to Thanksgiving and some people certainly found out they couldn't talk about certain things at the family table. That's what Alberta is like, because everybody works in oil one way or the other. Thank you, Thomas. Yeah, the smiles. I think what I love most about that are, okay, underneath that, the music is, there's a reversed sort of like deconstructed mixed version of me playing the Red River Jig, which is a Métis fiddle tune that describes and celebrates a moment of Métis national sovereignty that was brutally erased by colonial forces. And Métis people moved further and further north and west up the river systems in search of a place where they could practice cultural sovereignty and regain the national sovereignty they already had in Canada. And my grandparents and great grandparents and my uncles all grew up with Métis fiddle playing. And so when I was a little girl and I would go back to my granny's farm in the summers, my uncles would just be like, hey, can you play the Red River Jig? And I mean, just seriously, like 3 weeks ago, I was in Southwest Florida helping my mom after she had a little heart attack. And my uncle drove all the way down from Manitoba, which which is like a 3-day drive. It's a very Canadian thing. And he's like, hey, where'd you bring your fiddle? I was like, yeah, you gotta get it out. What good are you without it? Come on, go get the fiddle. And I had this sense of a kind of a birthright. And that's what that film, which was like a kind of a trailer for the spoken word project that I do. But that sort of signals for me as me coming into a more authentic relationship with the circumstances of my life, the conditions of my birth, and recognizing that there are, in the midst of unspeakable destruction of downstream from the oil operations, cholangiocarcinoma that has killed 6 to 8 people in the town of Fort Chipewyan, where in the United States, the entire population of the United States, 8 cases per year. In a town of 1,200, 6, which was subsequently squished by the Canadian government and denied and concealed. And the doctor, John O'Connor, who brought the word out to this, was temporarily stripped of his medical license. I mean, these are the kinds of punishing silences about oil where I come from. And so what I see in this, when I look at it now, 4 or 5 years later, is me tentatively taking my first steps at breaking that silence. So I guess I have to conclude with a kind of a gratitude towards myself and all of the people who you see smiling in the video, who welcomed me, who are new friends, who welcomed me back home, particularly Métis and First Nations friends, who told me I needed no other reason to come back home other than the fact that I was alive and that I was born there, the fact of my birth. So I just hope that I can offer that to other people, the work that I do. Thanks.
Thank you so much. This is all so beautiful. And I always feel like I want to have a lot more time to actually talk with people afterwards too. But alas, I'm going to pass it to Mike now for our last question.
So yeah, that was great. Thank you everyone for sharing. And I have one quick question. It's sort of a lightning round question because we have about a little bit over like 10 minutes left. So yeah, and thanks for sharing. Like I said, I was not prepared for all these bars. I love all types of music, and I used to be a rapper back in the day. So I really enjoyed that, like, everyone was dropping KRS-One and Ice Cube, and then, you know, Lila was spitting too. So my question is, while we're talking about this decolonization and the roles that music plays in your lives and the lives of our communities, with this event, we think this is a great platform for learning and understanding not only the differences in how we view music, food, and environment, but it's also a platform for finding commonalities as well. So for each of you, I have a question that I'd like you to answer. And if it's possible, do it quickly. I could listen to it for hours. But the question is, what have you heard from the other panelists that resonated with you in some way about either like something that they've shown, something that they've talked about? And we can go, I'll give you all, Thomas, you got a thought?
I'm sitting here taking notes the whole time. Okay. First, grandmother's hands. So I was raised by my grandparents, and that's how I got into gardening. And my grandfather, who's Seminole, but we didn't learn that about him until right before he died. You know, and it's been not a secret, but it's something that our family's still trying to uncover and learn more about, you know, actually who we are. You said that it took me back there, like, whoa. Then to see Lila walking, you know, up the hill and just listening to all the words and everything that you said. I mean, I can just quote you. I mean, my goodness, you know, I was just like, okay. You know, so my heart was just racing. It was just racing because I'm like, and when you were spinning them, when you started speaking in your native tongue, I'm like, wait a minute, hold up. She's not playing. Like, she's calling us out. She's calling me in, actually. That's how I felt, like you were speaking to Richard, the kid inside that my grandmother cared for. You know, she loved her little chubby grandbaby. Brian, okay, so I'm a vegetarian, been one for 22 years, used to weigh 302 pounds at my heaviest, lost 165 pounds. Now I'm, you know, maintaining like 175, 180, and now I've been cooking for the last 3 months, and it's kept me healthy and all of that, and it's because of what you said. I cook, they say kale. No, I was raised on collards, so we're going to go and get that.
All right, you know, I love Black Eyed Peas. You know, I love making like veggie burger, but I just, I understand, like, there's ecological grief and people don't even realize that they have it if they are disconnected from the food or from the land. And what you did, brother, I just want to say that that was it. And Tara Sands songbook, you know, three sisters here, of course, Kristin, but you know, Lila, Tanya, made me think about a movie called Mossville, Where Great Trees Fall, which is why I said it was hard to watch, you know, to watch a town, you know, that was established by Black people and then taken away, you know, by an oil company, and to watch that, it was just like, whoa, and that's part of my story. So just to see that, I wanted to thank you all for sharing it, and you definitely touched me, and I hope that was less than 2 minutes. I could do this all night though, but I'm stopping. I have so much more that I could say, but that's it. I'm blown away. Thank you all for letting me be here with you.
Thank you, Thomas. Anyone else want to jump in, or anyone feel like they want to? Oh, Tanya, looks like you have something. Looks like you might want to. Do you want to jump in, Tanya? Do you have any thoughts?
I mean, I'll jump in. I mean, the moment that Bryant started talking, he began his remarks with lyric and set the tone. Thomas, you're talking about how you said, if I'm not here, you're going to have to do this on your own to your students, how you're preparing them, the love and the compassion and like the fierceness of that. Lila, music was speaking to a whole body. It was speaking to the whole heart. And your lyric, we don't have to hide anymore. The only weapons that are useful in this battle are the weapons of truth and compassion. Like all these words are just, they're fueling me. So thank you.
Thank you. Oh.
Yeah, no, thank you all so much. I think one of the things that really resonated with me was this idea of like finding our ancestral foods and eating them. I think that's more than just a spiritual reconnection, although it is importantly a spiritual reconnection. It's also a very pragmatic thing, because what feeds me is not necessarily what will feed everyone else, because my DNA is adapted to a very particular place. And like our sheep, we have an endangered sheep that's four-horned sheep. It's sacred. We've been living with it for tens of thousands of years. And this sheep, their breath stimulates a microbiome in us in a way that European sheep cannot. And so our breath stimulates the microbiome in our sheep in a way that someone from Asia or Europe or Africa could not, because they haven't been living with them the way we've been living with. And vice versa, I could go to Ethiopia, which I have been blessed to go to, and see all their beautiful livestock. And I wouldn't be the magic that livestock needs, you know, because I haven't lived there with them. And so I just really encourage all of us to remember where we're from and find those foods, because it can be so specific what we need to eat to be whole with our specific DNA and DNA specific foods. So that's all I want to say. Thank you.
And last but not least, Bryant.
I think generally I'm inspired by all the panelists. Y'all so brilliant, and could really listen to y'all all day. I think the thing that I've been kind of contemplating throughout this conversation, just thinking about the different ways in which all three of you sit in the academy, and how just really trying to negotiate, like being in the academy and being in it, but not necessarily of it, and pushing it back against it, using its resources. And I have been out of the academy for a long time, but next year I'm gonna be visiting scholar / resident artist in the African American Studies Department at UC Berkeley for the academic year. And so not only am I thinking about the project that I'll be doing, which will really be moving my body of work into the contemporary art world, but just thinking about how I want to be situated in the academy at this point in my life, and you know, what will be useful, what I can discard, how I can push back. And so this has definitely given me a lot to think about, and thank you. I feel honored to sit with you all today.
Thank you, everyone. That was amazing. If we were in person, I'm sure we would have a standing ovation for all of you. And yeah, thank you. I want to thank you all personally, and Kristin and Thomas, Anna, Tia, everyone that helped bring this together. So I just wanted to remind everyone that we'll be having more of Earth Week events like this. We're going to have another event about music. Again, this is going to, again, we're going to shift a little bit to Colombia to talk about the Magdalena River, cumbia music, and all that sort of stuff. And then also the connections with sustainability there. And then our other future, well, I have a typo there, but like some of our other events that we have coming up are on the 19th of April. We're having an event about the IPCC report, looking at that from a global to a local perspective. And I will be moderating that event. And then the next day, the 20th, we're going to talk a little bit about how COVID has changed the streetscapes in New York. But I think we'll also get into a bigger urban context. And like I said, on the 29th, we're going to have a musical event again. So if you all like this event, and you like hearing live music, or recorded music, sorry, or if you're interested in more talks about music and the environment, please feel free to scan the QR code, and that'll take you to where you can basically sign up for these events. And yeah, I'll pass it back to Kristin to play us out with the song that she picked.
Keep doing that. I'm going to tell you all about this song real briefly. This is our outro music, but first I want to also thank our panelists and artists for sharing your time and your art and your wisdom and your insights with us. Thank you so much. This has been so amazing. And so this song is called Pink Moon by Valerie June. It's a cover from another artist named Nick Drake from the 1970s. So the pink moon is the April full moon, and it will be on Saturday this week. It's called the pink moon after a northeastern flower called the pink phlox. But this being a moon doesn't necessarily just go by the names that one group calls it. It has many names, might have its own name as well, but I don't know what that is. But in English, these are English words that I'm going to use, so I apologize. But sugar bushing moon in Ojibwe, the duck bird moon by the Cherokee Eastern Band of the Cherokee Indians in North Carolina, the planting moon by the Seneca, one of the tribes in what is now New York State and Southern Ontario. And this information comes from the American Indian Alaska Native Tourism Association. And the pink moon, or any of the names we might call the April full moon, of course, occurs at the time of renewal and growth and coincides with many spring holidays and holy days, including Ramadan, Passover, and Easter. So we're going to play this as outro music. You can stay with us for a couple more minutes, or you can leave, and we'll thank you again for joining us. Mike, you were going to play it. Or I can if you need. Thank you, everyone.
I have it. Sorry, I'm looking for it for the link.
I've got it.
Start reading it as I see. Pink moon is on its way.
Thank you. Have a good afternoon or evening, depending on where you're located.